थैंक्स फॉर पॉइंटिंग इट आउट। ओके सो वी वर डिस्कसिंग द टर्नरी ऑपरेटर। ओके सो टर्नरी ऑपरेटर इट इज इनहेरिटेड फ्रॉम सी एंड इट वर्क्स लाइक अ कंडीशनल। ओके इट्स अ सिंपल वे और अ कॉम्प्लिकेटेड वे द वे यू सी इट टू राइट द इफ एल्स स्टेटमेंट। ओके सो इट वर्क्स इन लिमिटेड सर्कमस्टेंसेज एंड द सिंटैक्स इज लाइक दिस। यू हैव फर्स्ट द कंडीशन, देन यू हैव अ क्वेश्चन मार्क, देन यू हैव सम स्टेटमेंट, statement one, let's call it statement one, and then you have a colon, then you have the second statement, let's call it statement two, and then you have the semicolon. Okay, the semicolon basically terminates this whole statement. This is one statement using a ternary operator, and the semicolon will terminate the whole statement. So how it works is that it will evaluate the condition. It will evaluate the condition, and based on whether the condition is true or false, it will either execute statement one or execute statement two. Okay, so if the condition is true, it will execute statement one and it will not execute statement two. Okay, if the condition is false, then it will not execute statement two, statement one, and it will execute statement two. Okay, so out of statement one and statement two, at any given time, only one of the statements will be executed. And that will be based on whether the condition is true or false. Okay, so this is a ternary operator. Just like this, the statement that Uzair has written. So it's an assignment statement, and on the right of the assignment statement, we have this ternary operator. Okay. So in the parentheses, you have this condition, and then you have the question mark, and instead of statement one and statement two, we have these values one and two. Okay, so statement one and statement two, basically it will be a value which will be returned by this statement, okay, by this ternary operator. So here the condition is player percentage two. What will be the result of this condition? What will be the result of this operation? Player percentage two. Let's say player is an integer. What will be the result of this operation? Player percentage two. One or zero. Okay, very good. Now, as we know that one or zero, if we put them instead of a condition, wherever we need a condition. Remember, condition. The result of a condition is always true or false. So if we put a number in a place where a condition is expected, true or false is expected, what will happen? If we put a number at a place where true or false is expected, a boolean is expected. If you put an integer at a place where a boolean is expected, what will happen? In C++, we had studied this in the very start of our course. There is something called implicit conversion, if you guys remember. What is implicit conversion?
So basically, sir, everything other than zero evaluates to true and zero is false, right?
Yes. So if you put, instead of, let's say you expect a value of type one at any place, and instead of type one, you put there a value of type two of some other type, then sometimes C++ will automatically try to convert this value of type two to a value of type one. Okay. So here, it was expecting a boolean and you guys supplied an integer. Okay, so C++ will automatically try to convert integer to a boolean. Okay, so this phenomenon where it automatically tries to convert one type to another is called implicit conversion. And for integer to boolean, it is clearly defined that anything non-zero will be converted to true and zero will be converted to false. Okay, so this player percentage 2, it will evaluate to either true or false. Okay, based on whether this condition evaluates to true or false, this assignment statement, it will receive either 1 or 2. If this statement evaluates to true, assignment statement will receive the value 1. And if this statement evaluates to false, assignment will receive the value 2. Is it clear, the working of a ternary operator?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
If we use auto, we'll discuss auto in next semester. Yes, who is it? Sime again, you want to ask something?
Sir, aap sub str function samjha sakte hain?
Sub str function, I'll have to look it up. Let me Google it. Sub str C++. The name says substring. It must be finding a substring. So yeah, name seems like a substring. Let me share my screen with you guys so you guys also see what I am seeing.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Wait a minute. Yes.
सर लाइट चली गई है सर, वो अभी हो सकता है मेरा इंटरनेट भी चला जाए सर. मुझे एक और कोई क्वेश्चन नहीं है, क्या मैं लीव कर सकता हूँ?
इफ द लाइट कम्स बैक प्लीज डू कम बैक बिकॉज देयर विल बी अटेंडेंस एट द एंड ऑफ द क्लास बट वी विल बी लाइक द क्विज. ओके, वी विल नॉट हैव द क्विज दिस क्लास, वी विल हैव क्विज इन नेक्स्ट, वी विल हैव द क्विज इन द नेक्स्ट क्लास थर्सडे एंड वी माइट हैव टू क्विजेस. I'll send an email. So substring, basically, I hope you guys can see this browser, returns a newly constructed string object. Its value can copy of a string of this object. Oh, it basically, you have a string. Let's say you have a string. You have a string hello, okay? So you want to create a substring, a new string, which is a substring of hello. Substring means the new string will be composed of letters that are located consecutive in the string hello, okay? So substring, you will give it the, what is this, arguments. You will give it the starting location, the position, and the length. Okay, so you will give it the position from which you want to start your new substring and the length. And what it will do is it will create a new substring and give it to you. Let's say we want to create a substring of these, let's say, three letters ELL. Okay. So if I want to create a new string of these three letters out of this hello, then I will have to tell the compiler from which index the new string is starting and what is the length of the new string. Okay, so it will go at that index, and from that index it will count the number of letters that you have given in length, and it will copy a new string for you based on this substring. Is it clear, Sam?
Is it clear?
Okay, so what will be the argument for this out of this hello? If I want to create this new string ELL, what will be the argument for substring? It's not dot, it's comma. Okay, so 3 is good and 2 is not good, I'm afraid. The index of E is what? One, okay? Yeah, so, that's about the substring. Anybody else has got any question? यस सॉल्व है।
सर व्हेन विल बी दिस वाइवा टेकन?
ओहो दैट्स अबाउट द लैब, यू गाइस टॉक टू द लैब इंस्ट्रक्टर फॉर दिस।
सर ही इज नॉट रिप्लाइंग।
सेंड हिम एन ईमेल एंड कीप मी इन कॉपी सीसी।
ओके सर।
Any other question? Because they'll take the Viva, so they will decide the date. I'm afraid I cannot say anything about it. Any other question? Yes, Usman.
Sir, हम किसी function को यानी किसी function को point किस case में करते हैं?
Pointer to a function.
नहीं नहीं यानी इन आर्गुमेंट नहीं आर्गुमेंट नहीं यानी फॉर एग्जांपल इंट पॉइंटर एंड फंक्शन का नेम ये हम यानी किस केस में करते हैं ऐसे?
लेट मी टाइप इट जस्ट टू बी क्लियर। सो इंट पॉइंटर f1 समथिंग लाइक दिस।
ओह यस।
Okay, so this is a function which is returning a pointer, an address. This far is clear?
So yes.
Okay, so in which case will we return an address? We have had examples in, I think, in the second assignment. You guys had an assignment where we were returning character pointers. In which case will we return an address? Anybody?
जो character array होती है उसका first element जो होता है वो उसका address होता है तो उस
yes.
case में
yes but that character array where will it be allocated normally? Will be it be allocated on the stack? Or on the heap.
Heap. Hum
okay.
Good. Se kariye usko.
Good. Yep. So if you have allocated some memory inside a function on the heap, and you want this memory to be accessed outside the function, I mean after it has been returned, then you will return the address of this memory so that the caller code can use that address to access the memory that you have allocated inside the function.
सर अगर हमें रैंडम नंबर
एक मिनट एक मिनट एक मिनट एक मिनट इज इट क्लियर उस्मान?
यस सर।
दिस इज द मोस्ट कॉमन केस वेयर वी रिटर्न एन एड्रेस फ्रॉम अ फंक्शन। ओके देयर माइट बी अदर केसेस आल्सो। ओके उजैर गो अहेड व्हाट वर यू सेइंग?
सर अगर हमें 0 से 9 तक रैंडम नंबर जनरेट करने हो कंप्यूटर से तो कैसे करेंगे?
ओके हु विल टेल अस दिस? व्हाट विल अ रैंडम नंबर व्हेन इट रैंडम नंबर जनरेट्स अ नंबर इट रिटर्न्स अ नंबर इट्स बिटवीन 0 एंड अ मैक्स वैल्यू। ओके सो इफ यू वांट टू लिमिट दिस रेंज इंस्टेड ऑफ फ्रॉम 0 टू मैक्स यू वांट टू लिमिट इट फ्रॉम 0 टू 9 व्हाट शैल वी डू? हु विल टेल अस? Then modulo 9, modulo 10 exactly, yeah? Modulo 10 is more correct than modulo 9. Uzair, did you get it?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, good. Any other question? Usman, you have another question?
No, sir. I'm going to hand raise. Karna, down. Karna bhul gaya.
No problem. Anybody else with any question? Any questions about anything that we have studied in the course?
Sir, ये ऐसे भी work करेगा मेरे ख्याल से जैसे मैंने लिखा है from 0 to 9.
No, he wanted numbers from 0 to 9. Your
हाँ,
code.
ये,
will, Yes, it will limit the numbers from 0 to 8. Zero, yeah, plus 1, plus 1 is good. But that, then the plus 1 is from 1 to 9. Okay, let me write it again. Rand percentage 9 plus 1. So the result of this will be from 1 to 9. Okay. Ozair wanted from 0 to 9. So for that, percentage 10 is more correct. Okay, any other question? Come on, this is your chance to like ask all the questions that I did not answer in the whole semester. And you won't get a lot of chances like this. What's the working form RAND? RAND returns a random number. If you want to say that what is, the code for RAND, how is RAND implemented? Like what's in the body of the RAND function? Is that what you're asking? Yes, RAND is a predefined function which comes in the C++ library. Okay, so you guys can directly use it. So what is in the body? I'm afraid I cannot answer this question right now. What you can do is you can Google C++ implementation of RAND. Okay, this will give you many codes about how this RAND function is implemented in C++. Okay, so just have a look at it. The code might go over your head, but it will be good to have a look at it. You might learn something. Ozair, please wait. This class will be finished at 5:30. Any other question? When do we have to use double pointers? Okay. So we use double pointers mostly when we have to store the address of a pointer. Okay. So when you have to store the address of a normal variable, you use a normal pointer. But when you have to store the address of a pointer, there can be cases where you are trying to store the address of a pointer, not the pointer which already contains the address, but the address of a pointer. In that case, you will be using a double pointer. Okay, so it might happen that you want to pass the pointer value to a function, but inside the function you want to change that pointer. Okay, as you know, if you pass a pointer value to a function, it will be passed by copy. Okay, so inside the function, if you change that pointer, it will be only the copy that will be changed. If you wanted to change the pointer that was passed to this function, then instead of passing the pointer, you will pass the address of a pointer or pointer to a pointer. Okay, and then using that address of that pointer, you will change that pointer from within the function. Okay, so this is one of the typical cases where we use double pointers or pointer to a pointer. Are 2D pointers in our syllabus? They are not in your syllabus, but it is good to know. I mean, you guys should not look at things in terms of only your exam and only your syllabus. You guys should look at things in terms of learning. Okay. So in terms of learning, the more things you learn, the better it will be for you and the better programmer you will become. Okay? So try to learn everything that you see, like as I was telling this morning to a couple of students, that C++ is a very big language. There are a lot of things in C++. In class, even after the second semester, you will have covered a certain amount of C++, but it will not be all of C++. So there will always be things that will not be taught in the class. Okay, so class syllabus will always be limited because our time is limited. But C++ is a bigger language, bigger than the time we have. So there will always be things that will not be part of your syllabus, but that does not mean that you should shy away learning those things. Okay? So try learning these things. They can always come handy at any point in your career. Yes, Mohammed Farah, you want to ask something? You muted yourself.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, now it's good.
Sir, we can use the ampersand sign to create reference variables, right? So if we have int ampersand in front of a function, then and if that function is for example an int function and it's returning value, then for example, I've seen cases like this where you can create an int ampersand function and you can use the function and assign it values and stuff like that. So I was just a bit, I just wanted to know how that works. So
int ampersand as a return type, you know, if we can have a simple int, we can have int star, which means the function is returning an address or a pointer, or we could have int ampersand as a return type of a function, which would mean that this function is returning a reference. Okay, so what is a reference?
It's just like another, it's basically another name for the same.
Good. It's another name for the same variable or the same memory location. Not for the same value, for the same variable or for the same memory location. Okay.
Right.
So let's say, let me rewrite this code. And let me first where this will not work. And then we will see where it works. No, let me rephrase it again. So remove this, and here we basically say okay, we'll leave it. We'll see the same that. So what will happen here? The code that I've pasted. We are returning X, and the function definition says that it has to return a reference. Okay. So what it will do is it will return what?
So the place where you've written function is equal to 30, it will assign the value 30 to the variable X, and then
now this this will basically evaluate, let's say this function is equal to 30 line in main, it will first evaluate the right side of the assignment operator, which is 30. Okay. And then it will evaluate the left side of the assignment operator. Okay. So the left side here, it says that func is returning a reference. Okay. So this will evaluate to the memory location, which is of the variable X. Okay. Because here we are inside the function, we are returning X. And since the return type is a reference, so this function will return a reference to X, or in other words, it will return a reference to the memory location of X.
Right.
Okay. So the assignment operator, what it will do is it will assign 30, or it will try to assign 30 to memory location of X. Okay. But the thing is, by the time this function returns, X was allocated on the stack. Okay. X is a local variable. So by the time this function returns, the local variables are destroyed. Uzair, the class will go on till 5:30. So if you will please stop interrupting, we'll be grateful. So the value or the variable x has been destroyed. Okay. So
right.
In this case, it's an error to return a reference, or in other words, it's an error to return a reference to a local variable. Is it clear?
So basically, the variable x is deleted after yes. the function runs.
Yes.
That's why you cannot use it.
Exactly.
Like this.
Right. Okay, so you can't use a reference to a variable which has been destroyed.
Right. So it will give an error. This
yes,
program.
This program will give an error. But this is not the program that you pasted, and this is the program I modified it a little. Now let me paste the program that you pasted. So here is the program that you pasted.
Yes, sir.
Okay. In this case also, we are returning a reference to X, or the reference to a memory location of X, but the X is not a local variable now. X is a static variable. Okay. And what's the lifetime of a static variable?
Until the program finishes, until it reaches the end of main.
Good. It will be created the first time this function is called, and it will live on until the end of function. So in this case, on line func is equal to 30, here this func will basically return a reference to X, or the memory location that belongs to X, and the assignment operator will basically store the value 30 in the memory location which is used by X.
Okay. Right. So basically, if we have this format, int ampersand function, and then we have a static int variable name, and then basically we can use the name of the function as a replacement of variables.
Yeah, because this function, the name of the function, mean you're doing a function call here. What the function call will do, a function call basically executes the code of the function. And this function call is replaced by the return value of the function. Okay, every function call is replaced by the return value of a function. And in this case, the return value of a function is the memory location of X. Okay, so on the right, on the left side of the assignment operator, we'll get the memory location of the variable X, in which the assignment operator can store the value 30.
Right. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense to me. Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Good. Any other question? Any other question? I'm not going to leave you before 5:30. So can you please explain void pointers? It seems you like pointers a lot. Void pointers. Okay. Sometimes you want to use a pointer, but when you are using that pointer, you don't know what type of pointer will I receive, or what type of pointer will I am going to use at that place. Okay. So what happens is, basically, when you don't know what type of pointer you are going to use, but you know that you are going to use a pointer, okay, but you don't know what type of pointer you are going to use. In that case, C provides you a functionality or a type which is called void pointer. Okay, so if you know that you are going to use a pointer, but you don't know what type of pointer you're going to use, in that case, you use a void pointer. Okay, so void pointer, basically, we say that void pointer does not have a type, and any type of pointer value can be converted into a void pointer, and vice versa, void pointer can also be converted into any type of pointer, which means in a variable of void pointer type, you can store the value of any pointer. Okay, and similarly, you can store the value of a void pointer in any pointer, which means It is perfectly all right if you have like int static p is equal to, let's say, some value. And then you can say void static q is equal to p. Or and also you can do int static z. So any type of pointer can be safely stored in a void pointer, and void pointer can also be copied to any other type of pointer. Okay. There are situations where we don't know in advance what type of pointer we are going to use. Okay. But we know that we are going to use a pointer, an address. But what will be the type of that address? Will it be the address of a character, of an integer, of a float? That we don't know. Okay. So in that case, we use void pointer at that point. And when we actually call that function or whatever, then we pass it the real pointer type that we want to use. Okay, so can void pointers store the address of char? As I said, void pointers can store any type of address. Okay, but void pointer is usually mostly used in C. In C++, we try to, I mean, they discourage the use of void pointers. Instead, we'll see in the next semester, in C++, they say that try to use, as less pointers as you can. We'll see that in next semester. Yes, Mohammed Farid.
Sir, I had a question. So when we declare a character pointer, and then we assign it in a string, then basically the pointer will automatically point will automatically get the address of the first character in the string.
Yes.
Is that how it works? Right. Okay. Thank you. I just wanted to confirm.
Okay. And where will this string be stored? The example this, that you have written.
This will be stored in the stack.
Remember, we said there is a portion that stores literals and
It will be stored in the, what was it called, the code segment? Is that what it's called?
No, code segment contains only the instructions. This is literal, it's not an instruction.
It should be in the initialized data.
Very good. It is in data section, and more specifically in the initialized data section. Okay, so the literal will be stored there, and P will get the address of the first memory location.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So, Usman Tar, couldn't we study OOP in Java? This is a good question, but in JIK at least, OOP is a paradigm or is a technique. Okay, it's a programming technique. It's language independent. You can study OOP in any language. So in JIK, traditionally, we study OOP in C++. The advantage of this is that until now, you have studied a very small subset of C++. Okay, you don't know the real power or real, complexity of C++ until now. In the next semester, we will study also the concepts of OOP, but in C++. So you will get OOP as well as more advanced or the real C++. Until now, whatever we have studied, 90% of it is C language. Okay, there's very little C++ that we have used. So C++ you will really study in the next semester. And as for Java, it is good to learn many languages, but the syntax of C++ and Java is very, very similar. Okay, so if you guys study OOP in C++, you can pick up Java on your own very easily. Okay, the syntax of both languages is very similar, the concept also. Is OOP going to be help for us? No. Rest assured, I think OOP will be more fun for you guys. Because right now you have like some basics in programming and some basics in C++. So you have like found your footing. So try to do as many assignments, as many projects as you can that you are given in this semester, So since you have be like solid ground in programming, so learning more advanced concepts, I think it will be easier than learning these beginner concepts. Okay, so the most difficult things are like these memory management and pointers that we have studied, types of variables, etc. Okay, if you have like understood these concepts well, then I can assure you that OOP will be fun rather than hell. Do we have lab in? Yes, you are like programmers. You will have labs in every semester. Programming is practice. I mean, you learn programming by practice. And practice, you do it in labs, not in classes. Any other question? Do we have a third degree? No, I think there will be a couple of other languages also, at least a couple of other languages. So, I mean, I think so, I'm not sure, but I think there will be other languages. Any other question? I don't know whether any course specifically uses Java or not. Yeah, Python, I think you can, I mean, you have some courses where you use, where you study databases, there you study SQL, which is another language for databases. And then I think there might be some courses which are related to AI, etc. So there you might, use Python or R or some other language for that is used for AI or data processing. Python is written in C++. No, the compiler for Python, I think, is, or the runtime for Python is written in C++. Python is another language. It's much easier than C++. C# also, I think you might study, I'm not sure. Okay, so let's continue this discussion in the next class. Okay. I'm sorry, yesterday I have to cut down the class short because we had some urgent business in the department. So if you guys want, we can have an extra session of these discussions or question answers on Friday. Okay. Or we can discuss it in Thursday's class. So right now I think I'll end because some people might be wanting to leave. Mark your attendance here and I will send you an email regarding the quizzes in Thursday's class. So thank you very much and prepare questions that you might have for Thursday's class and we can continue our discussion. So thank you very much and I'll now stop the recording and leave the chat.